chaos at Britain's airport. Major terrorist plot to blow up aircraft.
Would it be carried onto aircraft in hand luggage?
An attack is expected imminently.
In August 2006, six young Muslim men were arrested in London on charges of planning to blow up aircraft flying to America. They believed in the same fundamental Islamic values that inspire the Taliban fighters who are facing the British Army in Afghanistan. The same values that inspired the rebels who fought against British rule in India 150 years ago.
Look like a deliberate act.
A deliberate act, sir.
The perpetrators of acts of violence against the West today believe they are righting the wrongs of history. Fueled in many cases by a sense of injustice from the actions of Britain's imperial past. In this series, we explore how the centuries-old history of conflict between the West and Islam can help explain the violence of recent events. We look at three great clashes between a Christian British Empire and Islam. In Palestine, in Sudan, and where our story begins, India. In 1700, there was a faith on which the sun almost never set. From the Atlantic to the Pacific, Islam dominated half the world for 1,000 years. Inside this world was the Dar-ul-Islam, the House of Peace, where submission to Allah was unchallenged and Islamic law prevailed. Here, Muslim success seemed God-given, providential. Beyond, in the non-Islamic world, was the chaos of the Dar-ul-Harb, the House of War. It was here, within less than a century, that a new world superpower, driven by conquest and commerce, appeared. This power also believed that its standing as a global ruler was divinely ordained. As the Christian British acquired the greatest empire the world had ever seen, spanning 64 countries across 5 continents, Islam retreated. Nowhere was this more true than in Britain's most important imperial possession by far, India. In the beginning, the British had only one ambition in India: to make money out of it. The second half of the 18th century saw a British trading enterprise, the East India Company, take over control of huge tracts of the subcontinent, backed by the British government and a vast mercenary army. By 1803, this private company dominated India and had penetrated to the heart of the Muslim Mughal Empire, Delhi. Here, the British found a culture very different from their own. Yeah. For 300 years, the Mughal emperors had ruled several hundred million people, most of whom were not Muslim. The Islam of the Mughals, Sufism, was so inclusive with its colorful rituals and shrines that it attracted people from all religions.
The culture of Delhi, by which I mean the Sufi culture, has always been a composite civilization. It's Hinduism mixed with Islam. Sufism is the form of Islam. It's Islam at its most tolerant and pluralistic. And the British, when they arrived in Delhi, found it very easy just to become an extra part of this great mixture. They weren't any more different from everything else than the Hindus and Muslims were from each other. And it was an enormously open, tolerant and accepting world. And so the British threw themselves into this with enthusiasm.
In 18th century India, it was almost as common for the British to take on the customs of Indians as the reverse. These pictures symbolize one of the happier moments of Islamic Christian relations. Englishmen living like Indians. The British representative to the Mughal court, Sir David Ochterlony, personified this Orientalism. Here he's dressed not in empire-building shorts and solar topi, but in full Mughal dress. There's a eunuch with a fly whisk, and his dancing girls perform before him. All very appropriate for a man who famously had 13 Indian wives, each with her own elephant. Any challenge to Indian culture was seen by the East India Company as bad for business. That is why the sovereignty of the Mughal emperors was respected, and why the company stopped Christian missionaries preaching in India. This was a time when the idea of different worlds clashing would not have made sense to anyone. Least of all to the man who built this church in Delhi, Colonel James Skinner. Skinner, who founded one of India's premier cavalry regiments, was the son of a Scot father and an Indian mother. He represented the old union of British and Indian cultures. He was a devoted Anglican, but respected all religions. Then, in 1852, 10 years after Skinner's death, a new vicar took over at St. James's. John Midgley Jennings represented a new wave of evangelism.
St. James Church has become the centre of an incredibly aggressive Delhi mission headed by the Reverend John Midgley Jennings. Jennings believes that the Mughals are the princes of darkness.
By the 1850s, a resurgence of austere Christianity had inspired a religious crusade to eradicate the wayward beliefs of Britain's imperial subjects. Thousands of petitioners had successfully demanded that the British government overturn the East India Company's ban on missionaries in India. As Jennings wrote,
"A strong attack must be made somewhere. The roots of ancient religions have here, as in all old places, struck deep. And men must be able to fathom deep in order to uproot them."
Jennings' arrival in India heralded a hardening of attitudes. The old tolerance had begun to melt away, and harmonious relationships between races and religions were being replaced by hatreds and intolerance.
One is very struck by the speed with which the British move in the late 18th century from being impressed by India, interested in India, wishing to study India, empathizing with India, cohabiting with Indian women, taking an interest in Indian philosophy and literature, to this sort of naked, high Victorian racism. As has happened in our own time, hyperpowers tend to move very quickly from self-confidence to extreme brash arrogance.
At the same time as coming to view their subjects as less than human, the British embarked on a massive project of social engineering.
From non-interference, it is to interference. The whole idea is Indians are barbaric. This is an obscurantist society full of superstition and full of peculiar and bizarre customs and rituals which have nothing to do with the civilized world. And it is the mission of the British Empire in India to make Indians civilized.
For the Empire's social reformers, this would mean British education, British values, and most importantly, British religion. To many missionaries like Jennings, the subcontinent was a battleground in which they, as soldiers of Christ, were struggling against the forces of darkness. Every convert to Christianity was a victory. Muslims and Hindus alike started to feel that their own religions were threatened.
And so they're talking about Christianity and Christians rather than British and
yes,
the Sarkar.
Yes, I think so.
Buried in the Indian National Archives, William Dalrymple has found dozens of references to the fear of Christian supremacy among both Hindus and Muslims.
It isn't a fantastic leap of the imagination by any means for the people of Delhi to believe that the company wishes not just to rule them, but to redeem them. Indian people all over North India are increasingly convinced that the company actually wishes to convert them by force. It's believable enough to cause huge panic across North India.
The cultural vulnerability that Muslims in particular felt was to open their eyes to a new form of Islam, one that would confront British evangelism head on. At the beginning of the 19th century, Islam was undergoing its own radical transformation in response to a perceived threat from the Christian West. In the deserts of Arabia, the demands for change were led by the militant Islamist Muhammad ibn Abd al-Wahhab. From the holiest Muslim shrine in Mecca, al-Wahhab propagated a fearsome fundamentalism that returned Islam to its pure and untainted roots. All traces of Western influence should be expunged at the point of a sword. Eventually, the message of Wahhabism reached India. In 1821, a young radical student from Delhi called Syed Ahmed had joined the pilgrimage to Mecca. He, like many other Indian Muslims, found the Wahhabi teachings irresistible.
When Syed Ahmed goes to Mecca, he comes under the influence of a teaching of an earlier reformer, basically saying, if you don't convert to my way of thinking, you are un-Islamic, and I have a duty, an absolute duty, to offer you one chance to convert, or I kill you. So he comes back to India, and his first duty, he says, I must return India to its rightful path, which is Islam. Now, at that time, the rulers of India are the British. Therefore, he makes war against the British.
Syed Ahmed's message was simple. These shameful rituals would have to go. India must be purged of the corrupt practices of his fellow Muslims and foreign rule. Syed Ahmed and his fellow Wahhabi radicals found a base here in Patna on the River Ganges. It was the center of the East India Company's most profitable venture, the opium trade. The drug was collected in warehouses on the riverbank and shipped downstream for export to China. To Syed Ahmed, opium taking was an offense against Islam, and the trade represented everything that was depraved about British rule. Professor Imtiaz Ahmed is director of Patna's public library. His ancestors were allies of Syed Ahmed's at the heart of the radical Muslim movement.
He found his most ardent followers in a family from the city of Patna, which is known as the Sadiqpur family. We belong to that family.
The Holy Gospel is written according to...
So their first objective was to remove the British from India so that Islamic government or Islamic society could emerge.
This is the place in Patna where the radicals set up their headquarters, now the town's roadworks department. It was from here that Syed Ahmed began to organize his struggle, his jihad, to rid India of Christianity.
During the last few years, fate has been so kind to the accursed Christians. My heart is filled with shame at this religious degradation. And my head contains but one thought: how to organize jihad.
The Patna Wahhabists began to create an underground network of what today we would call terrorist cells, sending followers from village to village to spread the word. They called their movement the Path of Muhammad.
You have all over the Gangetic Plain these cells, this underground movement made of these small cells who linked up and who gradually fed young men, arms, funds, all the way up the Northwest Frontier, all of it hidden, using codes, using secret messages, so the authorities had absolutely no idea what was going on. They were concerned about the Wahhabi movement, but they had no idea that they were actually becoming a revolutionary movement.
The message was always in a camouflage manner. Now, if you look at these sentences which are underlined here, they speak about the need for reforms, about the need for purifying one's life. They say that this adherence to the true ingredients of the faith is possible only when you are able to run your own affairs. And therefore, in order to achieve this objective, you must first get rid of the alien government.
But according to Islamic teaching, for this jihad against the British to be legitimate, it had to be declared in a place where Islamic rule was already constituted. There was no choice. To take on the British in battle, Syed Ahmed and his supporters had to retreat from India to the pure Muslim air of the Afghan border.
Syed Ahmed gathers his followers together, he goes to Peshawar, and that's where he begins his campaign to re-establish Islam. And he finds a place in the hills which becomes known as the camp of the Mujahideen, the camp of the holy warriors. And amazingly, that camp survived up in the hills for over 150 years.
Today, the British army is fighting modern-day jihadists here. And Syed Ahmed's camp, from which he launched his attacks on the British, has become a stronghold for Taliban and Al-Qaeda fighters. When Syed Ahmed was killed in 1831, the British must have thought their troubles with the jihadists were over. So 16 years later, when British officers captured some troublesome cross-border raiders, they were amazed to find that these people were not local Afghans or Pakhtun tribesmen. They were the next generation of Wahhabist radicals, inspired by Syed Ahmed, still planning their jihad against British rule. Syed Ahmed's jihadists were about to change the face of India forever.
So we welcome all of you this morning in this house of God for prayer, worship, and fellowship.
By 1850, both sides of the fundamentalist divide, British evangelists and Islamic fundamentalists, were entrenched in India. Two faiths at the height of their intolerance. Intermarriage had all but disappeared, to be replaced by racial separation. In half a century, a vibrantly multicultural world had splintered into its component parts.
You're moving from a world of different faith happily coexisting. And what you see instead is that the increasingly aggressive and increasingly assertive Christian domination of the East leads to virtually no interracial or interreligious contact whatsoever. This shouldn't be a surprise. If you have an aggressive foreign policy invading other countries, it should hardly be a surprise that you get an aggressive reaction. I mean, it makes perfect sense. And yet, then as now, people are surprised.
This racial apartheid generated a revolutionary fervor. Flyers and posters appeared all over northern India, urging people to rise up to protect their culture and faith. Chapatis were passed from village to village as a secret symbol of unity against the British.
And it's interesting, the British are never referred to as the British or the English, Angrez. The word Angrez is never used, the word Gora, white, is never used, the word Farangi, foreigner, is never used. Instead, they speak almost exclusively of the Nasrani, the Christians, and the Kafirs, the infidels.
In 1857, this clash of fundamentalisms came to a head. This would be no border squabble. It would be something much bigger, a vast and bloody revolt in which a great empire in decline would confront a great empire on the make. A battle in which Christianity and Islam would go head to head. The Indian Mutiny would be a war of religion. The British were able to rule India because of their army, the largest collection of mercenary soldiers in the world. But by 1857, the general malaise of intolerance and alienation had affected the Hindu and Muslim foot soldiers of this army, the sepoys. As their fears worsened, the sepoys' respect for their British officers dissolved. On Sunday, the 10th of May, after months of tension, Britain's worst fears were realized. In the garrison town of Meerut, the British community had just attended Sunday service at St. Stephen's Church in an atmosphere of high anxiety. The day before, on this parade ground, sentences had been handed down to a group of rebel soldiers. In an act of extraordinary insensitivity, the British had ordered the sepoys to use new cartridges that were rumored to contain pig and cow fat, promising instant defilement for Muslims and Hindus alike. The rebels had refused and were dragged away in chains. Here was the final proof that the British wanted to turn them into Christians.
Taking a sepoy's uniform away and then putting shackles on him is probably the worst possible humiliation. Especially because he feels that he hasn't done anything wrong. He was only trying to defend his own caste and religion. And for that, his trusted superior white officer is now punishing him.
This was the breaking point. On Sunday afternoon, several thousand soldiers joined the mutiny against their British officers.
When the mutinies break out, what the soldiers are shouting is Deen, Deen, which means faith, faith or religion. The British were setting out to deliberately undermine their faith. It was their religion that was under threat.
The soldiers were immediately joined by an angry mob from the town, and the killing started.
Because it was a battle to preserve their own religion, the slogan was, kill the Firangi, maro, Firangi ko maro. And they just went and killed. They turned to the white people. No matter who it was, could have been a superior officer who had actually been had been very kind to them. They just killed.
By the end of the evening, 41 European Christians were dead, including 8 women and as many children.
Within hours of the mutinies happening, you find that the general population has joined. This gap between the civil population and the sepoys is bridged within hours. And what begins as a mutiny becomes a general uprising very, very fast. Because the sepoys are actually drawn from the common people. So the grievances are the same.
A few days later, the Reverend Jennings was scanning the surrounding countryside with his telescope, his daughter Annie by his side. What he saw was an advance party of mutineers gathering beneath the walls of the symbol of Indian Mughal rule, Delhi's Red Fort. Once inside, the mutineers demanded to see the old man who lived there. Abu Zafar Sirajuddin Muhammad Bahadur Shah Zafar was the last Muslim emperor in a line that stretched back 500 years to Tamerlane the Great. For years, he had been politically impotent in the face of British power. Yet the mutineers, Muslims and Hindus, demanded that the emperor lead them to reclaim India from the British.
Zafar was the ideal monarch to rule Delhi at the period before the uprising. He had no political power, but was in a fantastic position to spark off a major cultural renaissance by virtue of the fact he was himself a major poet, a very profound writer on Sufism, a calligrapher. In fact, aged 82, he could not have been more magnificently unsuited to lead a rebellion against the greatest military power the world had ever known.
Although the great majority of the sepoy mutineers were Hindus, many of the insurgents described themselves as Mujahideen, or jihadis, and a hardcore were Muslim Wahhabist radicals. Their part in the events that followed was to be crucial.
They are saying, we have a common enemy, we will join you. So it is a common focus of resistance, which the jihadis in Delhi are spearheading.
Overnight, the great Mughal capital was turned into a battleground. The religious nature of the uprising was immediately apparent. A local Islamic journal, the Delhi Urdu Akhbar, described the events as they unfolded. It was in no doubt that the sepoys were guided by the hand of an angry God.
God has given the Christians such a body blow that within a short time this carnage has utterly destroyed them. For he has powers over everything and has overwhelmed all their schemes and ploys.
Within hours, Padre Jennings and his family were dead, cut down with swords as they hid in their Red Fort apartment. In language that could have come out of an Al-Qaeda press release, the Delhi Urdu Akhbar reported that there was something miraculous about the ease with which the British were being dispatched.
Englishmen are still being discovered, and thanks to divine prowess, being easily overpowered. Their arrogance has brought them divine retribution. The English are now suffering under the blows of the unseen power because of their enmity towards Islam.
Despite reluctantly accepting his leadership of the revolt, the emperor had managed to protect some European prisoners in his private prayer hall in the Red Fort. 5 days after they arrived in Delhi, the Muslim rebels came for the prisoners, and despite the emperor's protestations, bound them and took them to a peepal tree in front of the palace drum house. As an eyewitness remembered,
they made the prisoners sit down, and one of them fired his carbine at them. After this, two of the king's personal armed retainers killed all the Europeans, men, women, and children, with their swords. There were about 200 Muslims uttering the coarsest abuse at the prisoners. After the slaughter, the bodies were taken on two carts and thrown into the river.
By the end of the day, scores of British in Delhi had been killed. The rest had fled. Three days later, a group of jihadi mullahs flew a green Islamic banner from the roof of the Jami Masjid Mosque. They announced a religious order, a fatwa, proclaiming the duty of jihad. For the Muslim population, it was a call to arms.
In the months that follow, you have large numbers of civilian Muslims taking up arms and fighting for their faith. And often these guys are completely untrained in the arts of war.
This was now no longer a simple military mutiny. It had become a revolt against the whole of the East India Company's rule and Britain's imperial project. Within days, the rebels had taken control of Delhi, and the uprising had spread up and down the Ganges Valley. Any British in the way, men, women, and children, were ruthlessly dispatched. Muslims in the countryside rallied behind their emperor in their thousands. Radiating out from Delhi, the green flag was raised in the small town of Tana Bhavan. The rebels declared the whole area Dar-ul-Islam, an Islamic state. And the British were no longer welcome.
حکومت یہاں پہ اسلامی تھی اور اس کو وہ ختم کر کے اور اس کے اوپر وہ اپنی تہذیب اور اپنا تسلط جمانا چاہ رہے تھے تو یہاں کے لوگوں کا ایک فطری بھی وہ جذبہ تھا.
From Tana Bavan, the rebels attacked the neighboring town of Shamli.
یعنی کہ جنگ ہوئی ان کی بہت زبردست, تو یہ بھی انگریز بھی مرا اور یہ علماء دین بھی بہت شہید ہوئے.
After a ferocious battle, the surviving government officials and soldiers were driven from their compound.
مسجد میں پناہ لی ان لوگوں نے, مسجد میں آ گئے انگریزی لوگوں نے اور انہیں شہید ہوئے.
23 government officials and soldiers were rounded up and murdered here, together with 130 local Indians suspected by the rebels of siding with the enemy.
بس کچھ ان کو یہاں سے لے کے چلے گئے پڑے بس مسجد میں, اور وہاں جانے کے بعد میں ان کو پھر لے گئے یہاں سے, ان کو دفن کرا یہاں سے, میں سب چلے گئے یہاں سے مسجد میں. سب ہم نے ایسے سنا تھا یہاں سے اپنے بزرگوں سے.
It was just touch and go, you know. I would say between May and October 1857, the British really did not know whether they would win back India.
For Britain to lose the jewel in the crown of its empire was unthinkable. Desperately rallying their forces in the north of India, by June, the British marched on Delhi, the epicenter of the revolt. Win back Delhi, eliminate the emperor, and British rule in India would be restored. In command of the British troops was an Ulster Protestant with a burning hatred of the mutineers. A man who through the sheer force of his will would turn the conflict around.
Well, this rather splendid slab of marble was taken from the Emperor's palace, and it covers the mortal remains of my great uncle, John Nicholson, or Nicholsane, who was perhaps the single most important man on the British side. He is the man who really galvanized the assault on Delhi. And his arrival turns the tide. He was, in many respects, an awful man, a psychopath, you might almost say, and probably single-handedly killed more Indians in that campaign than any other person. There's an account of him riding up in his stirrups and actually slashing down with his saber and splitting a sepoy in half.
Nicholson demanded that the British government pass a bill
for the flaying alive, impalement, or burning of the murderers of the British women and children of Delhi. If I had them in my power today, I would inflict the most excruciating tortures I could think of with a perfectly easy conscience.
Facing Nicholson on his arrival in Delhi, a hard core of jihadists. This was their headquarters, the Fatehpuri Mosque in the heart of Old Delhi. After many Hindu sepoys had melted away, hungry and dispirited, the proportion of Muslim jihadis in Delhi grew to be half the total rebel force. Among the rebels was a group of suicide jihadis, hardcore Wahhabi Islamists, prepared to fight to the death against Christian soldiers hell-bent on revenge. On the 14th of September, 1857, the British assaulted the city through the Kashmir Gate. It was to be a bloody last stand by the rebels.
The British believed that once they got within the walls of Delhi, once they breached the walls, that the opposition would simply run away and they'd win. What they found, to their horror, was that those who remained to the bitter end were clearly prepared to die for for their cause and were in no sense willing to give an inch. It looks for 4 or 5 days as if it's the British rather than the rebels who are going to break.
In the end, it was Delhi's Indian population that was on the receiving end of the most brutal revenge killings.
There is an old tradition that if a city fails to surrender, anything goes. And I think this is almost the last occasion that I can think of when the British exactly followed that rule, which is to slaughter everyone you meet, man, woman, and children, whether they're old or young, armed or unarmed.
As Nicholson's forces pushed through the city towards the Red Fort, killing as they went, the rebels and their leaders were wiped out. William Hodson, the British head of intelligence, captured 3 of the Emperor's sons as they escaped the city on a cart. He ordered them to strip naked and then personally shot them dead at point-blank range. Most of the Emperor's other sons were tried and hanged. Hodson wrote to his sister the following day.
I cannot help being pleased with the warm congratulations I received on all sides for my success in destroying the enemies of my race. The whole nation will rejoice. I'm not cruel, but I confess I did enjoy the opportunity of ridding the earth of these wretches.
The emperor himself retreated to the tomb of his ancestor, the second Mughal emperor, Humayun, a vast mortuary edifice 5 miles south of the city, from where he was led through protesting crowds into captivity. It was the end of the revolt in Delhi. But with much of northern India still in rebel hands, for the British, this was only the beginning of a long period of soul-searching and bloody revenge. Two weeks after the British had smashed the last resistance in Delhi, Queen Victoria declared a national day of humiliation and penance. The murder of hundreds of women and children by the rebels, more than 200 in Cawnpore alone, incensed the British. This wholesale murder of innocents confirmed to the Victorians that India had rejected the benefits of Western assimilation. That this was no less than a struggle between morality and savagery.
There was a deep sense of outrage, because it wasn't just one massacre. These are massacres going on throughout Upper India. It wasn't just the men, as had previously happened, it was the women and children. And I think also on the evangelical side, a deep sense of shock that Britain's Christian mission to civilize and transform India into a Christian nation had been challenged. I think it was almost going against God's will.
In churches across Britain, sermons demanded what amounted to a call for a holy war against the perpetrators of these unholy crimes. It would take 18 months for the British to re-establish their control of India with a savagery that has never been forgotten.
Down the Grand Trunk Road, every tree had 4 or 5 Indians who were just strung up and hung or shot. Any native who they caught was hung. Every Indian was considered to be a rebel.
The killings were justified in the eyes of Victorian evangelicals by their reading of the scriptures. It was no longer mass murder, but divine justice. This was the British jihad.
the Delhi Gazette, the principal British paper. He says the punishment about to be inflicted will likewise be equivalent. Justice is mercy. Blood for blood will be the watchword throughout the storm pending over this doomed city. The British soldier must hurry. The avenging angel uses you in the massacre that awaits your advance in Delhi. In other words, the British believed that God was using them as the instrument of divine retribution, which is a very, very frightening idea.
British officers wanted to make an example. Look, if you turn against us, this is what we are going to do. And just as rebel violence in the early months of the rebellion had been indiscriminate, the counter-insurgency violence of the British was also indiscriminate.
In one way, the violence of the British retribution was focused. Despite the fact that the mutiny had taken place initially among the sepoys, 85% of whom were Hindu, the British recognized the uprising as mainly a Muslim plot. And in Delhi, they took revenge by hanging Muslims in their thousands.
Thousands of Muslims, especially religious leaders, were hanged on the trees just for creating some fear and some terror. Thousands of dead bodies hanging.
It's overwhelmingly the Muslim upper class who are hunted down and hung en masse.
In one Delhi neighborhood alone, Kucha Chalan, some 1,400 citizens were cut down by the British army. Among the dead were the intellectual elite of the Mughal Empire. As a young official in the emperor's household wrote,
there was Mayan Amir Panjakash, the great calligrapher, who had no one comparable to him on this earth. Then there was one of our greatest poets, Imam Baksh Sabai. We will never see their like again. Meanwhile, many of their women were so disturbed by what they saw that they left their homes with their children and jumped into the wells. My pen refuses to describe this further.
The British had no such reticence. One officer wrote of the rebels,
they were not human beings, but fiends, or at best, wild beasts, deserving only the death of dogs.
Over 3,000 Muslim residents of Delhi were tried and executed, either hanged, shot, or blown from the mouths of cannon, often on the flimsiest of evidence. As if killing its inhabitants was not enough, the British then set about wiping Delhi and its Islamic heritage off the map.
The British, once they've captured Delhi, really just simply wish to erase Delhi from the face of the earth. Palmerston in London even writes, delete Delhi. Chichester, who was a British officer, a good Catholic boy, here he is writing about what he wants to be done in Delhi. There are several mosques in the city, most beautiful, to be looked at, but I should like to see them all destroyed. The rascally brutes desecrated our churches and graveyards, and I do not think we should have any regard for their stinking religion.
Not far outside Delhi, situated next to the domes of one of the oldest Sufi shrines in India, lies Zafar Mahal, the wrecked and ruined summer palace of the last Muslim emperor of India, Bahadur Shah Zafar.
With the end of Bahadur Shah Zafar, with the apocalyptic British retribution, the hanging of as many members of the court as they could find, this whole world was utterly destroyed and rooted out. Just down there, in front of the wonderful white domes of the Moti Masjid, the Pearl Mosque, is an empty grave, and that was the grave that Bahadur Shah Zafar wished to be buried in.
The emperor never got his wish. At 4 a.m. on the 7th of October, 1858, 332 years after the Mughals conquered Delhi, Bahadur Shah Zafar left the city on a bullock cart. His destination was Burma, to which the British banished the old man at the age of 83. In the years that followed, the British set out to destroy the last traces of the Indian Wahhabi network. In Delhi and Patna, they succeeded. But if the British thought it was all over, they were wrong. The uprising of 1857 was not forgotten. In 1866, two jihadi rebels who had escaped the British purges after the mutiny founded a religious school or madrasa here in Deoband near Delhi. Their inspiration came from the teachings of the fundamentalist Wahhabis who had instigated the 1857 uprising.
Those two students who survived the mutiny years, they were conscious that Islam could no longer take on the British by force of arms. It had to be more subtle than that. So they essentially tried to embark on a revitalization of Islam through ideas.
Come on. We have about 3,500 students. This is the biggest class where 800 students sit under one roof before one teacher. This is our internet section. This institution was set up for the revival of Islamic culture, Islamic values, and Islamic teachings.
They teach a form of Islam which we would regard as intolerant. It's fundamentalist, it's purist, it regards many other forms of Islam as heretical. At the same time, it had enormous influence. They turned to the poor of India, they turned to the poor Muslims, and they said, we will give your sons education here for free. And within a period of 30 years, had become the leading example of Islam in India.
Deobandism has remained a peaceful force for purifying Islam through ideas and education in India. But elsewhere, it has become a vehicle for promoting violence, transformed by two world-shattering events. In 1979, the Soviets invaded Afghanistan and oil prices went through the roof.
We have petrol, the price of petrol zooming up, and suddenly the Wahhabis in Arabia have huge sources of funds available. And which madrasas do they support? Naturally, those that are pro-Wahhabi. And so we have a situation now where the Deobandi and Wahhabi madrasas are dominant in the Northwest frontier. Those religious political parties actually run the frontier, and the Pakistan government is powerless.
This reunion of Deobandism with its Saudi Wahhabist roots set the stage for an exponential rise in the number of Deobandi madrasas. By 1985, there were more than 7,000 in Pakistan. The students are known as seekers of knowledge, or Taliban. The Taliban came out of Deobandi madrasas in Pakistan to create the most reactionary Islamic regime in modern history. They are inspired by the same ideas that drove the jihadis to fight against the British 140 years before.
مسلمانوں کے افکار تعلیمات اور ان کو تغییر اور تبدیل کرنے مسخ کرنے کی کوششیں کر رہے تھے اب بھی وہی حالت ہے کہ مغربی یا اسلام دشمن قوتیں جتنی بھی ہیں وہ اسلام اور مسلمانوں سے اپنے دین اس کے شعائر اس کے تعلیمات اور ان کے عقائد کو چھیننے اور ان کو مسخ کرنے کی کوشش کر رہے ہیں
We have these two strands the original Wahhabi seed implanted in the 19th century and then the modern Wahhabi seed being taught in the madrasas coming together to form the Taliban, and I would argue also to some extent to form Al-Qaeda.
This Deobandist religious college is just outside Peshawar on the Pakistan border with Afghanistan. Most of the Taliban leadership were educated here. It is the same place from which the Wahhabist Syed Ahmed issued his fatwa against the British in 1827. Many students from this and many other Deobandi madrasas along the frontier have fought and continue to fight against the British and American soldiers in Afghanistan. Then last year, the destructive impact of Deobandism was felt closer to home. In August, six young Muslim men were arrested in Walthamstow, East London, on charges of planning to blow up aircraft flying to America. The local mosque they attended is a Deobandi mosque preaching the same fundamental ideas that inspired Syed Ahmed 170 years ago when he made his pilgrimage to Mecca. The same ideas the mutineers fought for in India. The same ideas that inspire a growing number of young Muslims in Britain today.
When we look at Islamist extremism today, it's working within a very old tradition in the 1820s and 1830s. Syed Ahmed saw Islam under threat in India, and he reacted by going on making jihad. And exactly what we see Osama bin Laden doing today and others doing today, which is to believe that the way forward for Islam is by taking on the West as opposed to working with the West.
Ya jo bhi jis waqt bhi ho aur musalmanon ke aqaid unke shaair unke tahzeeb o tamaddun ko tabdeel karne ki koshishe karenge uske baqa ke liye jab musalman uthenge Islam ke baqa Islam ke tahzeeb tamaddun ke liye to wo jihad kehlayega khwa aaj ho ya 170 saal pehle ho ya 1000 saal pehle ho ya aainda zamane mein ho.
Next week, a self-proclaimed Muslim redeemer takes on and trounces the might of the British Empire in Sudan.
And that's at 7 o'clock next Sunday here on BBC Two. Coming next, Top Gear.